إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah. وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the best guidance that we have is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وشر الأمور محدثاتها. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وكل محدثة بدعة. And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وكل بدعة ضلالة. And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وكل ضلالة في النار. Every going astray and every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثم أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, although we always keep reminding ourselves with this ayah, it's one that you could hear every day and it can shock you in a different way. And it's the one we constantly remind each other with. وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. And it's the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, and the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, O my Lord, verily my people deserted and abandoned this Qur'an. They didn't learn it, they didn't listen to it, they didn't implement it, they didn't act on its laws and its orders. And although we've heard this much for the last, this ayah many times for the last few weeks, in hoping to be from those who do not abandon the Qur'an or desert it, but to be of those who fulfill it and implement it, we have to look at its messages, and from them is an ayah that we have to start applying to every action and statement and thing we do. And this ayah, وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنَّ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. This ayah is, and perhaps you look at this matter as something small or little, but عند الله, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is something tremendous. Something not just great, tremendous. It's a big thing, it's a big matter. In Ramadan, we made efforts to change our lives, to live more positively, to make positive changes. And we worked at that during Ramadan. And there's a concise advice from the Prophet ﷺ that can fix our ibadah, our worship, that can fix our relationships, and it can purify our souls from greed and from being discontent. We have a hadith from Abu Ayyub radiallahu anhu. He said, جَاءَ رَجُلٍ إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَقَالْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ عَلِّمْنِي وَأَوْجِزْ. He said to the Prophet, a man came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, O Messenger of Allah, teach me something, but make it brief and concise. I don't need a long list. Just give me something that's going to be the guidance I need in some brief words. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِذَا قُمْتَ فِي صَلَاتِكَ فَصَلِّ صَلَاةَ مُوَدِّعٍ وَلَا تَكَلَّمْ بِكَلَامٍ تَعْتَذِرُ مِنْهُ وَأَجْمِعِ الْيَأْسَ عَمَّا فِي أَيْدِ النَّاسِ. This hadith, which is Hassan in the Sunan of Ibn Majah, the Prophet ﷺ told him, when you get up to pray, pray every prayer like it's your last prayer, like you're bidding farewell, like it's your last hurrah, your last bye-bye, and you're never going to be able to pray again, because you won't make the next prayer. Do not say anything from your tongue that you have to apologize for. And give up what you hope for from what the people have. Stop looking at what the people have and longing for it for yourself. So let us take this advice and apply it, because it all goes back to that ayah. If we apply it, وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. We look at something as if it's minor or small, but with Allah, it's a great matter. The first one that's mentioned, إِذَا قُمْتَ فِي صَلَاتِكَ فَصَلِّ صَلَاتَ مَوَدِّعٍ. And if you stand up, when you stand up to pray, pray like a man who is bidding farewell. Prayer, many people act like it's not a big deal. There are many who fast and they did not pray one day of their Ramadan. Or there are some who, because they're fasting, they're praying, and when the fasting is done, they don't pray the rest of the year. And they act like it's insignificant to miss a prayer at all. Or there are some who say, well, if I miss a prayer here or there, you know, for the most part I pray. Or there are those who pray beyond its time, or rush it, or pray so fast that it looks like a woodpecker pecking for some food on the ground. Eating food, there's no tranquility, there's no calmness in the ruku' and the sujood. So we belittle this matter. وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. How many of us make that salah a small matter? But with Allah, it's from the most tremendous, as you're going to see and be reminded with. We have no guarantee today that we will be able to pray Jum'ah in a few minutes. We have no guarantee we'll make it to Salat al-Asr at 5, Maghrib at sunset, or Salat al-Isha at 10. There's no guarantee of that. Not because we're pessimistic, but because it's reality. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul will taste death. قُلْ إِنَّ الْمَوْتَ الَّذِي تَفِرُّونَ مِنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ. The death you're trying to flee from, it will find you. And there's nothing you can do. Not even the strongest built home will protect you from that death when it comes to find you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He guided us. Who wants to be a believer? You don't have to physically raise your hand. Mentally, you raise your hand. We all want to be from the mu'mineen. We all want to be from the believers on the day of resurrection. Allah, He laid out their description. And we need just the first one He mentioned. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Successful indeed are the believers. Who are they? What are their characteristics? الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those who, when they're in their prayers, they have humility. They forget the world behind them. They humble themselves before Allah. They're in a state where they're yearning and pleading to Rabbil Alameen to guide them, help them, aid them, protect them, and get them through their dunya on success. Successful indeed are the believers, those who, in their prayers, when they offer them, they're solemn, and they have submissiveness and they're tranquil. Another aspect of the prayer, as if it's salat muwadda'a, yani a farewell salah, is that you should do it in their time. How many of the people say, well, I'll do it, you know, I'll pray. You tell your children half the time. Pray all your prayers when you come home, even though they're not at their due times. And this is guidance which is batil, it's corrupt. Because it is not what is commanded of us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, فَوَيْنٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. He said, woe be to those who pray, or wail could be a valley in Jahannam, to the ones who pray. So you read this ayah by itself and you're like, why would Allah give Jahannam to someone who prays? Because the next ayah, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. They are those who eat with their prayers, they delay them past their fixed times. They don't pray them in their times. وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You're making matters such as praying on the right time, such as praying with tranquility and submissiveness, such as taking your time in the prayer. You're making them minor, but with Allah, they are grand things. My brothers and sisters in Islam, we should pray every prayer like it's as our last, as if we could see Allah and He's in front of us. And this is what ihsan is. Al-ihsan, when Jibreel alayhi salam, he came and he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اخبرني عن الإحسان. Tell me, what is ihsan? He said, أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فهو يراك. He said that you worship Allah as if you see Him, but knowing that you cannot see Allah, you know that Allah sees you. This is the ibadah that reaches that high level. For the one to have khushu', he prays as if Allah is right in front of him, watching him pray with every move. So remember, when you're rushing to the prayer, especially with the recitation of the Fatiha, especially with the ruku' and the sujood, remember the ayat, يَوْمَ يَكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ. Remember the ayah where Allah says, remember the day when the shin of Allah, the lower leg, not like the leg of the creation. لَيْسَ كِمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَسَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ. Allah, His sifat, His descriptions of His face, His eyes, His hands, His leg, is not like ours. There's nothing comparable to Allah, and He's the all-seeing, the all-hearing. But when Allah exposes His shin and its beauty and its majesty, at that time, on the day of resurrection, they will be called to make sajda, to prostrate to Allah, but they, the hypocrites, will not be able to do so. خَاشِعَةً أَبَصَارُهُمْ تَرْهَقُهُمْ ذِلَّةً وَقَدْ كَانُوا يُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ وَهُمْ سَالِمُونَ. Their eyes will be cast down, ignominy will cover over them, and they used to be called to pray in this dunya, to offer prayers while they were healthy and good in this life of this world, but they did not do so. May Allah protect us from being in this situation, Amen. That we cannot make sajda to our Creator on that day of resurrection. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he reminds us of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَا يُحَاسِبْ بِهِ الْعَبْدِ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ مِنْ عَمَلِهِ الصَّلَاةِ فَإِنْ صَلَحَتْ فَقَدْ أَفْلَهَ وَأَنْجَحْ وَإِنْ فَسَدَتْ فَقَدْ خَابَ وَخَسَرْ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said an authentic hadith, which is Hassan in the Sunan of al-Tirmidhi. He said, the first of a man's deeds. Okay, you upon Tawheed, you're on one side, the rest of you is on another. Now you upon Tawheed, come forth. The first of the deeds that they will be asked about on the day of resurrection will be the Salah. And if the Salah was good and sound, then you will be safe and successful. But if the Salah was incomplete, you will be unfortunate and be a loser in a state of loss. The first thing will be asked about. How can we make something so grand to Allah? الصلة بيننا وبين الرحمن. The connection between us and the Most Merciful One. The Salah, the prayer. The one that the Prophet ﷺ said, it's Umud al-Islam. It is the pillar of al-Islam. That prayer, how can we belittle it with Allah? Even though with Allah it's azim, it is tremendous. Al-Bara'a. He mentioned, رضي الله عنه, قال كان ركوع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وسجوده وإذا رفع رأسه من الركوع وبين السجدتين قريبا من السواء. This hadith which we have in al-Bukhari, al-Bara'a, he mentions that the bowing, the ركوع of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the sajda, the prostrations of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the coming up from ركوع and standing before you go to sajda, and the جلسة بين السجدتين, the sitting between the two sajdas, they were all equal in length. They were all equal in length. Look at those who pray with such speed, as if they have no concern but to just finish the prayer and say they finished the prayer off. Abu Qatada radiallahu anhu, he mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the worst kind of sarraq, the thief, is the one who steals from his prayer. The companion said, radiallahu anhu, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is going to steal from his prayers? He says he does not fulfill the ruku' and the sujood. Afwan, he does not fulfill the ruku' and the sujood of the prayer properly. That the ruku' is done with the back straight. That it's done with humility. That the bones rest. That he comes up until he stands straight. Till he's ya'tadil. Till he's qa'man. Yani he's standing straight and his bones rest. And he makes sajda with his palms and his face and his forehead and his nose, his knees and his toes on the ground. But the forearm and the elbows are up. He's doing the sujood correctly. Not as we see some, when they're making sajda, the whole arm is on the ground, and this is incorrect. The forearm and the elbow should be off of the ground in sajda. The nose should have the same pressure as the forehead in sajda. All of these things, when you miss them from your prayer, someone is stealing from your prayer. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, reflect upon this point. When you lose 20 bucks, when you lose a piece of jewelry, when you lose a piece of paper, for God's sake, you go crazy, you'll cry, you'll panic, you'll call friends, you'll say, help me, you'll do whatever you have to do because you've lost something that is valuable to you. Who wants to lose Allah? When you do not pray, when you cut off your prayers, you cut that connection between you and your Lord. So this is not something you should belittle. وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You look at something as a minor thing, but with Allah it's tremendous, and from the tremendous things is the prayer. The second part of the hadith that the Prophet ﷺ advised the questioner with. He said, وَلَا تَكَلَّمْ بِكَلَامٍ تَعْتَدِرُ مِنْهِ. Do not say anything for which you have to apologize. Do not say anything with which you have to apologize. How many times before Ramadan, during Ramadan, throughout the year, do we advise about guarding the tongue? maintaining the tongue, being conscious of what you are saying. Do not say things you have to apologize for. I've seen brothers with my own eyes in tears because they said something wrong to someone. And that person died before they can go and make it up to them. Or died before they can go and ask for forgiveness. Or died before they can make that up. So, do not let those things haunt you in your life. وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيَّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْعَظِيمِ وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٍ. You make what your tongue says to be a minor matter. As if Allah cannot hear you. As if your angels don't know how to record what you say. But what your tongue says is a heavy, tremendous matter with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليقل خيرا أو ليصمت. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, let him who believes in Allah on the last day say what is good or be silent. And our Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. And our Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said that the majority of the sins of the children of Adam are because of the tongue. And Shaykh al-Albani, Sahih, he graded this as hadith in Sahih al-Jami'. So do not speak unless your speech is good. Unless there's clear benefit. And when there's even a doubt that what you're saying might bring harm, or evil, or argumentation, or the likes of these matters, zip your mouth. And restrain it. And complain about it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get you through it. An Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, rafa'ahu qal, إذا أصبح ابن آدم فإن الأعضاء كلها تكفر اللسان فتقول اتق الله فينا فإننا نحن بك فإن استقمت استقمنا وإذا وججت عججنا. This hadith which we have as Hassan in the Sunnah of Tirmidhi, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, when the son of Adam wakes up every morning, all of his body parts, they bow down to the tongue. They say, fear Allah regarding us, because if you are good, then the rest of us will be straight. If you are straight, the rest of us will be straight. But if you're crooked, then the rest of us will be crooked. Do not say anything that you have to apologize for later. If this is something you would have to apologize for, it should be something you don't say in the first place. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. One time he was with Umar radiallahu anhu and he was grabbing his tongue and pulling it hard with severity to the point that Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, مَهْ غَفْرَ اللَّهُ لَكْ. What are you doing? Stop this. Allah has forgiven you for your sins. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, this is the first best in the ummah after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The best one. Promised Jannah. And look how he calls himself to account. Look how he judges himself. He said, إِنَّ هَذَا أَوْرَضَنِي الْمَوَارِدِ. He said, indeed, this piece of flesh that's so small between my two jawbones, it has brought me to destruction. From Mu'adh ibn Jabal, we know we have the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, فَأَخَذَ بِلِسَانِهِ فَقَالَ كُفَّ عَلَيْكَ هَذَا. He said, restrain this, restrain this. Mu'adh said, are we going to be held accountable for what our tongues say? And he said, may your mother be bereaved of you, O Mu'adh. He said, وَهَلْ يَكُبُّ النَّاسِ عَلَى وَجُوهِهِمْ أَوْ عَلَى مَنَخِرِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدَ أَلْسِنَتِهُمْ. He said, O Mu'adh, will someone be poured or spilled or thrown into the hellfire on his or her face or on his or her nose except because what the harvest of the tongue is, because of what the tongue harvests, meaning the speech that you give? يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ أَلْسِنَتُهُمْ وَأَيْدِيهِمْ وَأَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. There's a day, there's no lying needed, there's no fibbing, no playing with the tails. There will be a day where the lips will be sealed. But the tongues, the hands, the legs, they will bear witness against them with what you used to do. وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You make what the tongue says be such a minor thing, but with Allah it is tremendous. وَلَا تَكَلَّمْ بِكَلَامٍ تَعْتَذِرُ مِنْ. Do not say or speak anything that you would have to apologize to somebody for. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم وأدعو الله يغفر لكم ذنوبكم. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله غافر الذنوب جميعها إلا الشرك به. والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وعلى صحبه وعلى التابعين إلى يوم الدين وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, The last portion of the hadith where the man asked the Prophet ﷺ to advise me, the first two. If you pray a prayer, the prayers, they're a fariba. You have to pray the five minimum. When you pray that prayer, pray as if you are bidding farewell. It's your last time you'll pray. Many of us who've made hajj, when you make tawaf al-wada' and you pray those two rak'ahs behind Maqam Ibrahim and you leave the masjid, not walking back, you turn and you leave and you go to your destination. You don't come back to the Masjid al-Haram after that, right? Unless your flight's delayed and like you, but you're not doing ibadah, extra ibadat after that. All of us remember that last walk who've made it. You've bid farewell to the Kaaba, to Masjid al-Haram, and you're going back to your home. This is how you should make your prayers, as if you won't get another one. Second, be mindful of what your tongue says. Do not say anything that you would have to apologize for. The last point was, وَأَجْنِعِ الْيَأْسَ عَمَّا فِي أَيْدِ النَّاسِ, and give up hope for what the people have. This is a hard one for many people, because we are material people and we live in a material world, and everything is I want, I want, I want. Even though we have those who have far less. And nowadays, again, we're seeing it on the TVs. Those suffering in Palestine, in Burma, in Shishan, in Chechnya, in China, the Uyghurs, in Kashmir, in India, all over the Muslim world. We don't even know, we can list every country, everywhere. And we have the nerve to say, man, I still want that. Because we belittle the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He's blessed us with. وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You are belittling a matter to be small, but with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is grand, it is tremendous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنْ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهُمْ هَوَاهُ وَأَضَلَّهُ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ وَخَتَمَ عَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَجَعَلَ عَلَىٰ بَصَرِهِ غِشَاوَةً فَمَنْ يَهْدِيهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ اللَّهِ أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. Allah says, what means, have you seen him who takes his own lust, his vain desires, the materials that he craves as his ilah, as his God? This is what fulfills him. This is what keeps him going. It's getting and getting and getting what he's striving after of this dunya. So much so that he is worshipping what he craves, his desires and his lusts. And Allah knowingly, knowing him as such, he left him astray and sealed his seeing and his heart. And he put a cover on his sight. Who will guide him after Allah? Will you not hear this reminder and then remember? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَنْ يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا نُؤْتِيهِ مِنْهَا وَمَنْ يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الْآخِرَةِ نُؤْتِيهِ مِنَّا وَسَنَجْزِ الشَّاكِرِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, and whoever wants the reward of this life, Allah said, he'll give it to you. And whoever wants the reward of the hereafter, Allah will give it to you. And we shall reward those who are grateful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَا تُمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ إِلَى مَا مَتَّعْنَا بِهِ أَزْوَاجًا مِّنْهُمْ زَهْمَةِ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا لِنَفْتِنُهُمْ فِيهِ وَرِزْقُ رَبِّكَ خَيْرٌ وَأَبَقَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, what means? Do not strain your eyes looking at and longing for the things that other people have besides you. The splendor of the life of this world, that we may test them thereby. This is a test for them. We all think if we have this, how many times have we said, man, if I had money, I would give in sadaqah. Man, if I had this, I would go to the masjid more. How many of us said those things? And it only led us to more destruction or corruption. But the provision, the good reward of the akhirah with Allah is better, and it's everlasting. There's no end to it. An Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he said, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَنْظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ وَلَا تَنْظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ فَوْقَكُمْ فَهُوَ أَجْدَرُ أَنْ لَا يَزْدَرُ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. This hadith which we have, which is muttafaqun alayhi in Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, if you want to look or compare your life, look at those below you. There's billions below every one of us. The poorest one in this masjid, the sickest one in this masjid, the one with the least in this masjid. There are millions, if not billions, lower than you in the sense of finances, good health, everything that you're looking for, an amount of children, whatever it is. Look at those below you. Compare yourself to those below you, not to those above you. Man, I want this car. I wanted this size of a home. I wanted this machinery. I wanted to be have this degree. Whatever you compare yourself to. When you do so, you belittle the favors and the blessings Allah has given you. You belittle them. It's like a slap in the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you look at someone who's above you and saying, I want this, 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 and you're not looking at all of the ones below you who have much less and far less than you. Be content, ya ibadallah, with what Allah has given you. Don't long for what you see and you think it's good for you. Allah said, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. You may think something is good for you, but it's going to be bad for you. And you may think something is bad for you, but it may be good for you, and Allah knows and you don't know. How many times did we ask for something that we thought would be beneficial or good for us, and it only got us to some harm or some evil? And how many times did something happen to us that was bad in our eyesight, in our thinking, but some good came out of it, and Allah knows and you do not know? قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأرضى بما قسم الله لك تكون أغنى الناس. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, be content with what Allah has given you. You, the one who's content and accepts what Allah has given you, to Allah, you're the richest of the people. Richness, wealth, being a wahid ghani, someone who's, you know, just so overwhelmed in wealth, this is not the one with the dollar signs in his account. It's the one who's content and praises Allah with all that Allah has given him or her. So success and contentment will come if your heart is saleem. يَوْمَ لَا يَوْمَ لا ينفع مال ولا بنون إلا من أتى الله بقلب سليم. The day where your will, your wealth, your children won't benefit you. All that will benefit you is that you come to Allah with a good, clean, pure heart. Pure of shirk, clean from shirk, pure and clean from nifaq, from hypocrisy. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he mentioned to us a hadith of the Prophet, or he mentioned that the Prophet said, لو تعلمون ما أعلم لَضَحِكْتُمْ قَلِيلًا وَلَبُكِيتُمْ كَثِيرًا. He said in this authentic hadith, which is Hassan in the Sunnah of Tirmidhi, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you knew what I knew, you would laugh a little and you would cry a lot. Doesn't mean it's haram to laugh. Laugh, but have that mindset that you're content with what Allah gave you, because there's a bigger picture here. It ain't this dunya, I hate to break it to you. It's going to be a barzakh, life in a barzakh, and then a question before Rabbil Alameen, the one who created me and you, and all that exists. And he will say, إِمَّا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَإِمَّا إِلَى النَّارِ. You're either going to Jannah, or you're going to the hellfire. Allah's Messenger, صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى صُورِكُمْ وَأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ إِنَّمَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى أَعْمَالِكُمْ وَقُلُوبِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in this hadith, which is sahih in the Sunnah of Ibn Majah, Allah is not going to look at your wealth. He's not going to look at what materials you come and meet him with that you had in this life. He's not going to look at your beauty and the forms of your bodies. He's going to look at your heart and your deeds. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, be mindful of this. Allah said, وَإِن تَعِدُّ نَعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to count the blessings of Allah, you would never be able to count nearly any of them. You won't be able to get to enumerate any of them compared to what Allah has given you. So be mindful of this. Verily, man is indeed an extreme wrongdoer. So my dear brothers, my dear sisters in Islam, know, أَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ مَنْ حَيَاتِ الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ وَلَهْوٌ وَزِينَةٌ وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ وَتَكَاثُرٌ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ. Allah says, know that the life of this world is only play and amusement. Pomp and mutual boasting amongst you, and rivalry that you have with one another in respect of wealth and children. Like a vegetation, when rain comes, it makes it green. You think you're on top of the world, you have your crops, but sooner than later, it all turns brown again and it dies off. So, وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ عَذَابٌ شَدِيدٌ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانٌ وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. So the end of the ayah mentions, but in the hereafter, there's severe torment for those who disbelieve. But there's a gardens of paradise, forgiveness from Allah, good pleasure for the believers and the good doers. Whereas the life of this world is only a deceiving enjoyment. وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You might think it's a minor matter when you compare yourself to someone who's above you, or you're longing for what other people have. But really with Allah, it's a tremendous thing. وَأَجْمِعْ الْيَأْسَ عَمَّا فِي أَيْدِ النَّاسِ. Give up hope for what the people have. If you do these things, pray every prayer like you're bidding farewell to this dunya, and then you won't have another prayer. That you don't say something you would have to apologize for. And you stop hoping and craving and desiring what you see other people have as if it's good for you to get it. Then inshallah you'll be of those who are successful. And will not be of those who abandon the message of the Quran and the Sunnah of His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma khfir lil muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minat al ahya' minhum wal amwat innaka antas sami'un qareebun mujib al da'awat ya muqallib al qulub thabbit quluban ala dinik ya muqallib al qulub thabbit quluban ala dinik ya muqallib al qulub thabbit quluban ala dinik subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun alal mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.